jazz. Jazz can be, and is, many different things. Currently playing is a man named Charlie Parker. He is one of the three fathers of jazz, along with Thelonious Monk and Dizzy Gillespie. Many other jazz legends include Louis Armstrong, John Coltrane, Mary Lou Williams, Duke Ellington, and Miles Davis. Jazz is a broad music genre that many people listen to. In jazz, there are four different sections: rhythm, saxophones, trombones, and trumpets. The first section is rhythm, which includes piano, guitar, drums, string bass, and occasionally tuba. Then there's the saxophone section, which includes alto saxophone, tenor saxophone, and baritone saxophone. Then the trombone section, which includes trombone, baritone, French horn, and bassoon. Lastly, there's the trumpet section, which includes trumpet, clarinet, and flute. Countless subgenres sprouted from jazz. The main ones include Dixieland, blues, ragtime, and swing. Jazz originated in the African-American communities of New Orleans and Louisiana. Jazz doesn't have a specific starting date. The first jazz album to be released was the Livery Stable Blues made by the Dixieland Band in 1916. The second most accurate date would be following the end of World War I in 1918. After the assassination of Archduke Ferdinand, much war occurred, and on February 3, 1917, the United States severed diplomatic relations with Germany. Then 2 months and 3 days later, we declared war on Germany. After years of war and around 40 million deaths, the Treaty of Versailles was put into effect. We won the war, but at the cost of our country entering economic and mental depression. The Great Depression, just 11 years later, deepened our already tragic country's economic crisis. What did people do? Create a genre of music that would help millions and entertain a ton of people around the world. Even today, jazz is considered one of the best forms of music. During the formation of jazz as a genre, cinema was born. No one person created cinema, a multi-billion dollar business, but in December of 1895, the first person or persons to show a projected film to an audience was the Lumiere brothers. Films were nothing like the ones today. Back then, they were only a few minutes in length. In 1909, the first film with color was shown. Jazz is a big thing in this day and age. It's also changed our world for the better. So how did jazz influence American culture, and how did it get so popular? I claim jazz gained much popularity and influenced American culture due to the signing of the JPA, the Harlem Renaissance, and speakeasies. Part of jazz was the Jazz Preservation Act, or the JPA signing. This act was signed on December 4, 1987. It was signed by the 100th Congress. This act was sponsored by John Conyers Jr., who was a representative for Michigan's 13th District. This declared jazz as an African-American art form. This also changed the way jazz was viewed worldwide. Because of the JPA, jazz artifacts were collected and preserved in museums. Jazz was now seen as an art. Intermediate and advanced jazz studies are taught and sought after. Jazz was valued for the genre it is and has become. For example, Louis Armstrong, the biggest name in jazz, had his trumpet go on auction. Some bids hit over $80,000. The average trumpet will normally go from $400 to $1,200. The nostalgia, along with many other things, have raised that trumpet's value an obscene amount. In many middle and high schools, there is an optional jazz band you can join. Without the signing of the JPA, those jazz bands would cease to exist. Jazz would be undervalued. Additionally, jazz wouldn't be as prosperous as a mediocre genre.
And there it is.
Before this era, the biggest and pretty much only major jazz spot was New Orleans. After this massive migration of over 6 million African Americans, there became many more opportunities to make a name for themselves, including Kansas City, Missouri, Chicago, Illinois, and New York City. Harlem, Massachusetts, where the name comes from, was also very big. It was littered with hundreds of thousands of African Americans trying to find a way to feed themselves and their family. Many of these people found jobs and gigs in these popular jazz spots. Jazz gave African Americans a way to voice themselves during a time of great controversy. It was important because in their recent history, they were silenced due to racism. The Harlem Renaissance was dedicated to giving African Americans rights and barrier breaking. Jazz just so happened to be the best way to do so. So jazz immensely influenced African American rights and led to more. On January 17, 1920, Congress passed the 18th Amendment, Prohibition. This change made all distribution and sales of alcoholic beverages illegal. Before Prohibition was passed, around 30% of the United States drank alcohol. During, it spiked to approximately 60%. Many people craved alcohol during this period of time. And where did people drink? Speakeasies. Often owned by criminals, speakeasies were a very common sight during the Roaring Twenties, which was from 1920 to 1929. The popularity of New York City, for example, about 20,000 to 100,000 of the establishments flourished during the 1920s. At these bars, the main source of entertainment was jazz. Speakeasy owners would often hire jazz musicians to perform while selling alcohol. If each speakeasy could hold 100 people, that would be 10 million drinkers during Prohibition. And that would be 10 million people listening to jazz just during Prohibition, not including before and after the 18th Amendment. This took jazz's popularity to a whole new level. But then, on December 5th, 1933, the 18th Amendment was repealed, making alcohol legal again. Bars were flooded, making jazz more enjoyable than ever. American culture wasn't the same, because jazz was a part of 13 years of Prohibition, and a massive part of it. Because from 1920 to 1933, alcohol was illegal, and jazz was the main sight to see. Jazz was an important part of American history and culture. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. agrees in his 1964 speech that he wrote for the Berlin Jazz Festival. While he didn't speak it himself, the transcript was purely his. So in the wise words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., God has wrought many things out of oppression. He has endowed his creatures with the capacity to create, and from this capacity has flowed the sweet songs of sorrow and joy that have allowed man to cope with his environment in many different situations. Jazz speaks for life. The blues tell the story of life's difficulties, and if you think for a moment, you will realize that they take the hardest realities of life and put them into music, only to come out with some new hope or sense of triumph. This is triumphant music. Modern jazz has continued in this tradition, singing the songs of a more complicated urban existence. When life itself offers no order and meaning, the musician creates an order and meaning from the sounds of earth which flow through his instrument. It is no wonder that so much of the search for identity among African Americans was championed by jazz musicians. Long before the modern essayists and scholars wrote of racial identity as a problem for a multiracial world, musicians were returning to the roots to affirm that which was stirring within their souls. Much of the power of our freedom movement in the United States has come from this music. It has strengthened us with its sweet rhythms when courage began to fail. It has calmed us with its rich harmonies when spirits were down. And now, jazz is exported to the world, for in the particular struggle of the black peoples in America, there is something akin to the universal struggle of the modern man. Everybody has the blues. Everybody longs for meaning. Everybody needs to love and be loved. Everybody needs to clap hands and be happy. Everybody longs for faith. In music, especially this broad category called jazz, there's a stepping stone towards all of these. Now please enjoy my trombone cover of Fly Me to the Moon by Frank Sinatra.